线上的好朋友大家好，欢迎大家准时收看全民开讲系列讲座。我是今天主持人 Grace， 是一位退休职业妇女，在职场生涯里经常碰到一些主管为求品质稳定，会订一些规范与要求，为求公司进步及永续发展，会申请一些国际证照，因为增加了一些工作或作业方式跟以前不一样，当时我也会排斥，但经过课程训练后，了解这些改变对公司品质、销售、经营都有很大的帮助，我也欣然接受，而且日后也觉得做得很顺手。但是我最近在网络上看了这些国际认证的会议，我觉得政府机关没有把两公约当一回事，还存在以前威权贪腐的时代，没有想让台湾走向真民主、有人权的民主国家。接下来我们来观看国际审查会议这段影片。
The recommendation of the committee back in 2017 was that the covenants be deemed part of the constitution of Taiwan, that they be given a constitutional position, which would mean, I presume, that they would prevail over any domestic legislation that is incompatible with that. And it seems clear that's not what has happened.
Because Taiwan cannot use this international complaint system, international communications. Yeah? If the domestic court does not solve, the victims in other countries, if they ratified optional protocol, they can still file individual communications to the Human Rights Committee or Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. But Taiwan cannot do that.
But...There is no clear specific crime in the domestic criminal code of Taiwan. Irrespective of whether the torture leads to death or injuries, this is not the important point. The important point is the deliberate infliction of severe pain or suffering on a powerless person. That's what makes torture such a terrible crime. So what prevents...what has prevented so far the government to implement our recommendations in the first and in the second, and now also with our list of issues. On the reply to the second list of questions, then it was said, as of March 29, 2022, a total of 410 applications have been accepted, of which two were further processed,and transferred to the disciplinary court trial. So 410 applications, only two were further processed, and then not to a criminal court, but to the disciplinary court. So there is something fundamentally missing, wrong, and that I think there is no independent authority to investigate and prosecute torture. Otherwise, I cannot imagine why...There are no consequences for torture that is obviously happening. Otherwise, there wouldn't be so many complaints about torture.
Freedom of religion. Well, there's nothing much from the government, and also nothing much also from so far that we have received. So if there's any burning issue that we really need to put on the recommendation, I think it's time to hear, I think, from our friends
here. Yes. Okay. Anything on freedom of religion that you would like to add, please?
太极门案其实是一个非常严重的宗教信仰自由迫害案件。这个案件 ，European Times 就是欧洲这边的时报杂志，对于其实有非常多的国际专家学者在讨论。寒冬杂志，它光是一年多就已经有100多位的国际学者专家针对这个案件做评论。他们没有罪，也跟税都没有关系，但是他们的土地却被政府以课税、以这个歧视为理由来没收他们的土地。
我们宗教人权公约的规定必须要有法律依据， 才可以限制宗教的活动的自由。但是我们台湾目前的状况是透过行政命令，没有法律的依据，没有法律的授权，就来剥夺限制人民的宗教活动自由。
The judge may have taken part to a considerable extent, for instance, in the investigation. Also, may he, so to say, have, during the investigation, made expressions which could be understood in the sense that he had already formed an idea of how the case should be decided. I recall, I think we all have heard of the old, well-known maxim that saying justice must not only be done, justice must also be seen to be done. This is a question of confidentiality of the public in the way the legal system is functioning. So my question would be whether the present situation under Taiwanese law, where impartiality usually only comes up as issues where the judge has made a decision, is too narrow.
I have always asked how Taiwan thinks about what Taiwan thinks about the Universal Declaration on Human Rights in particular, and about human rights education in general. So mind you, this is now the third time that I have been here. On the average, that's what? At least 10 years, right? From the first time that I came here. And up to now, I feel like a failure. And you know why? Nobody seems to be interested in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Without the Universal Declaration on Human Rights, there would be no international covenant on civil and political rights, nor would there be a covenant on economic, social, and cultural rights, and all the others that followed after.
The two covenants have been in force in Taiwan for 13 years. However, they simply exist in name. Human rights are not being respected in government agencies. Over the years, the international reviewers' concluding observations and recommendations have not been taken seriously. The two covenants have yet to achieve the same power of the Constitution of Taiwan and basic human rights guaranteed by the Constitution, such as the right to effective remedies, anti-torture, and freedom of religion and belief, have not been implemented.
由以上这段影片得知，我们未将两公约纳入宪法，未通过任责议定书，所以无法向国际公正公约委员会提出诉讼，也就是说无人可管。谈到酷刑更离谱，有410件投诉，只有2件送惩戒法庭处理，其他 99.5% 却不了了之。还有太极门宗教信仰自由遭受迫害案等等。台湾推行两公约已13年，但只是表象的空壳，政府机关对人权、宗教信仰自由及反酷刑未受重视，而且毫无改善，实在让人叹息。接下来，我们来观看另一段国际审查会议影片。
中华民国联合国反贪腐公约第249号报告国际审查会议。
台湾不是缔约国，但是为了与国际接轨，2015年政府通过了联合国反贪腐公约施行法，三年后完成第一份国家报告与审查，在经过四年持续推动下，今天8月30号展开2022年联合国反贪腐公约第二次国家报告国际审查会议，邀请五位来自秘鲁、美国、纽西兰、南韩、澳洲之国际反贪腐专家担任审查委员。
虽然台湾不是联合国的会员，也没有参与联合国反贪腐公约的缔约，但是我们善尽了该公约赋予国家的义务，我们努力的来实践公约所要求的工作内容。
如果一个政府或者是相关的机构不能反贪腐， 我们政府就没有行政的效力能力，我们的司法审判就没有公平正义。
早上记者会于九点半举办，后续的会议采闭门方式，并将于九月二号下午的结论性意见发表记者会，公开审查内容。
Well, I think Taiwan has improved significantly in the ranking of the CPI, the Corruption Perception Index. But of course, as has been mentioned by the Premier and me, we believe there's still enough room for improvement. And we have heard right now from a member of the Legislative Yuan and members of the civil society organizations that there are some very relevant issues that need to be addressed. One of those is the Whistleblower Protection Act that is being sitting without a final decision to send it with a final version to Congress.
在审查会议现场的外面，出现民众聚集手持布条抗议的场面。他们痛斥政府说一套做一套，尤其是财税体系的奖金制度。
越高阶领越多，有的呢，好什么绩效好的不得了的税务员，开单就可以拿奖金，也造成了恐怖的贪腐乱源。为什么台湾的税务机制在平反的过程中非常的恐怖？因为呢，我们的设计机制是一开单呢，那个人就必须要缴二分之一、三分之一的担保品，才能够去确定这个案件真或假。假税单是真抢劫，而且你提了行政诉愿诉讼，不停止强制执行。所以只要执行署的长官看到，哇，这一笔一千万太好了，我现在缺这个绩效，我就硬干到底，执行下去，那个人就抄家灭门了，没有经过司法公正审查。
这个看起来我们台湾现在的政治是朝腐败的地方去走，那整个在贪腐报告里面我看到的都是歌功颂德，那不敢去面对真相。而且现在贪腐是官员结构性贪腐啊，根本就不会惩治啊，而且明目张胆。
为了让国际社会更了解台湾在民主价值的捍卫决心以及打击贪腐的具体作为，即使不是联合国会员国，仍会以国际上最高标准作为行动的准绳。民众更希望政府能真心倾听百姓的冤屈和诉求，确实改革制度，防堵贪腐发生，让冤屈不再发生，冤案得以平反。记者彭敏华、王文琴台北采访报道。
由行政院主办、法务部及廉政署承办的2022联合国反贪腐公约中华民国第二次国家报告国际审查会议，9月2日下午举行结论性意见发表记者会。虽然是记者会，但对记者的拍摄及采访仍有所限制。这种不透明的审查会议是否能反映台湾真实的现状呢？民团打上大问号。
这样的一个闭门的会议啊，其实就是政府要欺骗整个世界，也要欺骗人民，其实就是这个国家整个彻底的腐败，整个彻底的贪腐。所以我的做法，我是认为我们必须要把这些罪状直接放到委员在联合国的桌子上，不需要来跟这个人争，因为他们不信任人民嘛，那人民只好走自己救济的路。所以我们要寄到联合国去，寄到欧盟的人权委员会去，寄到上次来的九人的桌子上去，寄到这次来的六人的桌子上去。我想人民就直接采取行动来捍卫我们自己的尊严和人权。
台湾财经刑法研究学会理事长陈志龙教授更质疑台湾公务机关存在拉帮结派系统性的贪腐。
三个C要一起抓出来，第一个C就是 cronyism， 就是近亲关系，多是以情代的政治关系。第二个就是 conspiracy， 就是勾串共谋。第三个 C 就是 corruption， 就是腐化。我们知道贪污的钱到哪里去，就叫做 ABC 原则。 A 钱就是把钱 A 到口袋里头，就是侵占，这叫 A 钱。 B 钱呢，就是不该逼人家的人，逼人家强制征收，没收人家财产，逼人家把钱缴出来，人家不该缴的钱乱七八糟缴，人家欠一点小钱，然后执行署就把那拍卖，叫人家有人甚至去跳楼，那这个东西都不对的。那吸钱就是做出一些很奇怪的东西，到处把人民的钱吸走。 ABC。
律师呼吁政府将联合国反贪腐公约纳为国内法，就应该善加援用，破除体制内的缺失。其中最迫切需要改革的就是奖金制度。
反贪腐公约它在国内是有特别法的位阶，它就是说只要是跟贪腐有关的，我们都是要以反贪腐公约作为优先适用。反贪腐公约施行法有讲说，只要不符合反贪腐公约的相关的规定，都应该要在三年内修正。那可是我们看到连上次委员来做结论性意见的时候的建议的一些具体的建议，包括要设定什么法律或者设定什么机关，我们到目前为止都没有看到立法院有相关的行为了。那更何况我们法税改革联盟一再强调的奖金这种结构性贪腐的事实上一直都没有被政府所注意，一直没有被政府所注意。可是它其实是一个非常严重的贪腐行为，因为奖金的诱惑，有可能是有譬如说税务机关他就为了追求绩效或是追求奖金来发出不合法或是不当的税单，所以我们认为说如果因为用单纯收税的数额当作绩效，就很容易造成贪腐的事实啦。所以我们在此再一次强烈的呼吁政府一定要把这个万恶的诱因奖金制度把它废除掉，把它回归到正常的薪资制度。
花了纳税人673万办了这场不公开、不直播、也不能采访的反贪腐审查会议，政府是否有心贯彻反贪腐的决心呢？还是又沦为另一场大内宣？年底大选将至，人民拭目以待。
有决心要反贪。
记者陈真君关心的台北报道。
公约所要求的工作内容。
사일간의회의에673만원을사용했습니다。原来台湾政府邀请国际人士来审查是如此关起门来黑箱作业。第二次反贪腐会议花了总共673万元，不透明不公开，这样花纳税人的钱你同意吗？而且所有主流媒体电视台等都没有来转播，只有少数网络直播组进场直播，但又被阻挡，说什么翻译有转版权不给直播，硬要记者下架，说什么违反智慧财产权。对此大学助理教授魏世聪表示，主办单位说所有的录音有版权，这严重违反了反贪腐的首要目的。
由以上这段影片得知，政府对反贪腐信誓旦旦，看到这么多人民举牌抗议，专家学者的陈抗声讨，财税不公，查税奖金更是万恶之源，难道政府官员都漠视不见吗？难道让不公不义的税制逼死人民吗？审查会议变成闭门会议，人民及媒体完全无法采访或直播，这是机密还是无法公诸于世，实在让人无法了解。台湾要进步，要成为真正民主、法治、主权在民的民主国家，希望透过节目呼吁全民觉醒，向威权说不，共同打击贪腐，破除官僚体系，让台湾成为真正民主、法治、自由与人权的民主灯塔。